In the world of video games, there are few franchises as famous or well-loved as Pokemon. With a small yellow mouse and a call to catch 'em all, Pokemon was able to take over the world and capture the minds of generations for almost 25 years. Since the franchise's launch in 1996, it has permeated several areas of entertainment, from the original video game, to card games, to anime, and even live-action movies. However, in all its time dominating people's televisions and wallets, Pokemon had never made the effort to try and make something that made a lot of sense, an actual fighting game, choosing instead to stay close to its RPG adventure roots. That is until 2015, when arcades in Japan were treated to a first of its kind, a fighter that attempted to blend the best the arena fighting genre had to offer with the more precise execution of the traditional 2D fighter, a game that would bridge the gap between Pokemon fans and the FGC, and create an entirely new generation of fighting game competitors. This is Pokken Tournament. Pokken first released, as many traditional fighting games have in the past, as a Japan-exclusive arcade cabinet. For almost a year, Japanese players were able to get a head start learning the mechanics unique to Pokken, giving them a distinct advantage against other players around the world. Unlike most fighters that typically stick to one style of combat or another, Pokken has two distinct modes of play in a single match. The field phase, that operates more like a projectile or arena fighter like Jump Force, and the more 2D-oriented duel phase. The field phase is much more like a dance, with each player vying for position and trying to create an opening. In the field phase, players are able to move in all three dimensions and harass each other with various ranged attacks. Similar to projectile fighting games like Gundam Versus or ARMS, these attacks can hone in on their target, but at the cost of damage. In the duel phase, players are pitted against each other in a more classic 2D setting. In this setting, the amount of damage done, as well as the number of moves that a character can string together, are increased exponentially. So while the field phase may be considered easier or safer, it's in the duel phase where most games are decided. Keeping in line with other fighting games, Pokken also features support Pokemon, which act similarly to the assist system found in most team fighting games, as well as resource and meter management, as extensive as Under Night in Birth. As a matter of fact, it's this intense resource management that many top players believe gives Pokken its unique identity. So with all of these different hybrid aspects to learn and perfect, the extra time Japanese players were able to spend grinding really made a difference. When players in the rest of the world finally got their hands on the game, it wasn't with as much fanfare as you might expect a competitive Pokemon game to have. First of all, the marketing for the game was incredibly lacking. It may have been hard to break through all the hype surrounding Pokemon's other big launch of the year, Pokemon Go, but many don't remember hearing about the game at launch.
We could talk about the launch of the game because it definitely had a rough launch. It definitely struggled from being more of a traditional fighter and being on the Wii U. On top of that, we barely had any advertising. I don't think I've seen a single trailer for the game except for when the Switch version was announced. It just wasn't marketed very well, and it was released on a very bad, unpopular system, which was the Wii U.
Of all of Nintendo's home consoles, the Wii U is easily its least popular. This, paired with the fact that the FGC has basically agreed on the PS4 as its default console, made sure that Pokken had nothing going for it as it hit store shelves. Despite this, Pokken's initial sales were higher than expected, outselling Street Fighter V by the end of its first month and topping 1 million copies sold by August 2016, 6 months after its release. Players were eager to jump into the ring with one another, but while its sales were high, Pokken lagged behind the competition in its ability to be played on LAN. Unlike other fighting games, Pokken has no ability to share a screen with your opponent, requiring them to play on a separate console connected by a LAN adapter. This effectively doubled the console requirements to play competitively, and put additional strain on TOs who often would have struggled to find enough consoles for a tournament to run smoothly. These challenges might have been enough to put other games down, but by virtue of its passionate fanbase and its unique and well-balanced gameplay, Pokken was able to establish a global competitive scene. As the scene began to take shape and competitors learned more about the game, a competitive meta started to form. The two players leading the pack were Suicune Master and Bimmy Question. These two couldn't possibly be more different, but both, in their own way, helped shape what Pokken would become. Suicune was consistent and efficient, utilizing multiple characters, and always on the hunt for the optimal pick. While Bim, the more eccentric Sceptile loyalist, would follow his gut when making decisions. These two, among others like Catfight and Roxo, would form the foundation of North American Pokken. But while they progressed in pushing the game forward, there were those in Japan who were still one step ahead after months of arcade grinding. When it came time for EVO 2016, no one knew quite what to expect. With Pokken still relatively new, every player knew that their knowledge of the game was incomplete at best, and this tournament would have in store for them types of competition they had never experienced before.
This third round, you gotta expend everything right now. And he's in a good... Is that gonna defend? Oh, man.
That, yeah, it's gonna be enough damage too. Might be able to...
That was so fast! Let's go, Weavile! He just got out of that fire spin into the Fury Swipe! Into his burst attack!
Yes!
Let's go!
Weird. Oh man, the bait!
Wait, got him! Wow! Yeah.
While the competition was fierce and the American players fought hard, it was the Japanese players, Buntan and Tonosama, who would square off in the grand finals and show eagerly awaiting viewers what it was that Pokken had to offer. Unfortunately, this is where our story takes a turn, because on the biggest stage in fighting games in the year of its release, what Pokken showed to the world was a bit of a disappointment. Tonosama, capitalizing on his exceptional game knowledge and many of his opponents' inexperience, decided to play Breaksin, a character not often seen at this point in the game's history. Utilizing her array of ranged attacks and her broken assist interaction with Yveltal, he proceeded to win EVO in what was considered by many spectators to be the lamest way possible. While this match, from a technical game standpoint, may have been incredibly interesting and informative to the competitive scene, to the average fighting game fan, Pokken appeared to be a slow-paced, projectile-filled snooze fest.
The grand finals, which is what everyone saw pretty much, ended up being a very, you know, stally match. For Pokken players, it was cool. We were seeing really clean for the time play. They were doing impressive things, but from an outsider looking in, it was very slow. And there were a lot of things in the game that aren't in the game now, or things that were happening that we didn't know how to deal with that we know how to deal with now. And that was a lot of people's first impression of the game. Actually hurting the game, unfortunately, and it's just a very unfortunate thing that happened.
This might normally signify the death of a scene. With a lack of enthusiasm for the title caused by a lackluster EVO performance, it would be easy to write the game off entirely. However, despite all odds, the money continued to come in. At the beginning of 2017, EVO hosted a fundraiser to once again determine the last main game of that year's event. Pokken was in attendance and ran a good race, but in the end, they weren't able to secure the seat. However, considering the amount of money that was raised by a clearly passionate player base, EVO decided to give the money back to the community, allowing them to disseminate the funds to various major tournaments to keep the scene alive. This shot of capital gave the Pokken community just enough of a boost to keep them moving forward and to keep interest up in the game.
With these events, honestly, I think that kept the scene alive because post EVO and Worlds, we did not know if we were going to Worlds next year because they announced almost immediately that there was VGC and TCG, but not Pokken. So we were kind of left up in the air. That bonus kept the scene alive because it kept the incentive, at least with monetary, of people going to these tournaments at least for like the last hurrahs to go before it falters out. But by the time the last pop bonus went out, we finally got news that we were coming back for Worlds. So that probably kept us alive because people would have maybe have left if they've not gotten any news about Pokken at the time.
This continued first-party support isn't unique within the FGC, but certainly uncommon for any game not made by Capcom or NetherRealm Studios. Beyond the support from the Pokemon Company, a player named Anthony Roxo Paratore took it upon himself to get more involved in the Pokken community and eventually take action to ensure that Pokken would have a place to thrive independent of first-party tournaments. What started with generous pot donations eventually evolved into a desire to run his own tournaments.
He decided to create his own tournament series. He started with an event called Final Boss, and it was in New Jersey. He wanted to make it like a once a year thing, and it was probably one of the most badass tournaments I've ever been to. It was just like a Pokken only tournament. And everybody and their mother was there, and even some European players and many of like top Japanese players were there too. They were all invited to come through, and it was one of the best times of my life. It was great. And after that, he created his another tournament called, he scrapped Final Boss and he wanted to make it even better, and then he created the Destiny series.
These events would help to jumpstart a new beginning for the Pokken community. A second life that gave rise to such stars as Slipping Bug, Twixie, and eventually Jukum. This new group defined the second era of Pokken, much in the same way that Suicune and Bim did in 2016, standing consistently at the top of the brackets and pushing the competitive meta forward. Up until that point, no one had really been fielding Lucha Pikachu, but Slipping Bug brought her to the forefront and forced the scene to grow and adapt. While no longer popularly used today, it's these kind of innovations that generate change in a scene and fuel its growth. At the same time, Liam Twixie Nelson had been climbing in the standings, eventually taking the crown and starting an era of supremacy that resulted in him racking up more tournament wins than any other player to date. However, his reign would not go unchallenged. Jacob Jukum Waller, a player from Illinois, who brought a trait largely missing from Pokken, confidence.
Jukum was just the definition of someone who was confident in his actions. He decided what he was going to do, and he didn't be like, oh, well, maybe I shouldn't, and then he got, and then you hit him. He knew what he was going to do, he did it, he executed it, and that was that. And I think that set him apart, because a lot of us were very hesitant. The Pokken scene was definitely a bunch of, scaredy cats, even at the top level. People were weren't immune to second-guessing their decisions. And everyone did it, so everyone kind of got away with it. Whereas Jukum forced things to happen. He was he believed in his decisions, so you had to keep up with him. And I think he made us a lot better because of that.
With the release of DX, Pokken was effectively overhauled, seeing characters previously released only in the arcade finally making their way to a home console, as well as a new character release just for this edition. However, while the change in the game certainly helped spice things up for the scene, it was the new console that really gave new life to Pokken. No longer relegated to Nintendo's least popular console, Pokken was now in the hands of more people than ever, seeing sales numbers that rivaled that of its original release. DX opened the door to a whole new world of competitors, and it showed. By the end of 2018, Twixie's reign of dominance had been slowing down, eventually leaving the scene altogether for other games. This meant that Jukum was now the de facto best in the world, and he would go on to become the 2018 world champion. But it wouldn't be long before a new challenger would arrive. Out of Germany came a new young gun called Wingtide, a player who had only come into the scene after the launch of DX and had a lot of ground to cover to catch up with the rest of the competition.
So he was new blood. This is the first time a top player was not a day one player. No one won like Wingtide did. He grinded so hard to catch up to everyone else, and he deserves everything he got. He has, to date, the best head-to-head record against against other top five players we've ever seen. The rate at which he improved was baffling. He ruined his sleep schedule to practice with North American players. He was so dedicated, it was insane. And it showed. It showed in his results.
For six devastating months from 2018 and into 2019, Wingtide sent the message that the level of competition needed to be raised, and aspiring champs of the next generation would need to level up if they wanted a shot at the top. After 6 months of dominance, the cost of continuously coming to America became too much, and Wingtide returned to Germany to stay as the undisputed king, leaving the NA throne vacant once again. At first, it looked like Jukum would retake the top spot, but during the height of Wingtide's reign, two other players had been making their rise, one in the tournament scene and one online. Offline, Oregon Hotshot, Chaz Mutator Wright, had been slowly climbing the bracket and tempering himself against the best the tournament scene had to offer. Online, there was Shadowcat, a day one player who spent 3 years never going to a LAN event. Devon Shadowcat Amos Hall was kind of infamous in the Pokken scene, an online boogeyman waiting to smash anyone that came his way. After years of staying behind the screen, Shadowcat was able to show up to Nationals and qualify after coming fourth in one of his first big tournaments. This set the stage for what would become a three-way rivalry throughout the rest of 2019, and the scene was hyped to see what 2020 had in store. Unfortunately, as we all know, 2020 has not been the best year for fighting game competition, and while some tournaments were held before quarantine, those tournaments did little to decide a new King of the Ring. Despite the challenges that Pokken has faced, the scene is still going strong. It may not pull in the numbers of something like Street Fighter or Tekken, but it's important to note that their numbers are consistent. Thanks to first-party support for competition, Pokemon's strong recognition factor, and the game's incredibly balanced gameplay that allows for crazy shakeups in the meta without massive patch overhauls, Pokken has been one of the most interesting and constantly evolving games in the FGC. Hopes for a sequel on the horizon are high, but even without one, the balance of the competitive scene is ever-shifting, and thanks to this, Pokken remains far from stale. Because of quarantine, Pokken, like many games, may be at one of its lowest points, but as long as this group of passionate players still strive to be the very best, Pokken will never truly die. This video is made possible thanks to our wonderful patrons.
A giant thank you to everybody on this list, and shout out to Arknox, Sammy, Shampoo, Weeaboo, Nathan, Nate, and Maw for being Platinum supporters. And an extra special shout out to Raffy, Noodles, and Marco for being our Diamond supporters.
Thanks a bunch, guys. It means a lot. We'd also like to extend an extra, extra special shout out to Undead Streaming for being our Grandmaster supporter. Once again, thank you to everyone. If you also want to support our channel and unlock perks, check out the Patreon link in the description below, or join our Discord server. If you want to help us out in a different way, leaving a like, subscribing, and hitting the bell to stay up to date is also appreciated. My name is Jonah. Thanks for watching.